Good morning. Good morning and welcome to Christchurch. It is great to see all of you here this morning, those of you here in the centrum and those of you who are joining us online. My name is David Donathan. I'm the Minister of Music here, and I thought I'd take a couple minutes this morning to welcome you to worship. Our lead pastor, Jay, is away this week on a clergy renewal leave slash vacation to the Chautauqua community up in New York, and it's the first time he's been. So he and Becky are up there this week and worshiping with them this morning, so we hope that he has a very restful and wonderful week. I want to take a couple minutes to introduce our guest preacher this morning. This is Reverend Jim McCune. Jim is the coordinator for disaster response here for the West Virginia Conference. He is still standing after spending about 10 days with 15,000 scouts down in the southern part of the state during their jamboree. And during that time, yes. And during that time, he helped lead an effort to fill 5,025 flood buckets, if you can imagine. Jim's previous appointment before retiring was up at Elizabeth Memorial, just up here on the top of the hill. So once again, would you welcome Jim to worship this morning? Again, it's great to welcome you to worship, so let's begin our time together.
Good morning. My name is Douglas Michael Haney. I'm the liturgist for today. Would you please rise as you are able and join me in the call to worship? We gather as a community of faith, hope, and love, serving in God's subversive world. We gather to celebrate that no darkness can extinguish light, to remember that love will always be more powerful than death, and to trust that peace will always be stronger than violence. We gather, people of faith, in the light of God's world. Thanks be to God. The hymn of praise is number 158. Come, Christians, join to sing.
Thank you.
Would you please join me in the gathering prayer? Holy God, we come together to worship, a people who would like to think that we love you with all our hearts and souls, with all our might. But there are so many other things in our lives that clamor for our attention that we often relegate you to Sundays and times when we want you to rescue us. Most of us really do want you to be the one in whom we live and move and have our being. We really do want to hear your voice above all of the other voices in our lives. But we get bogged down in the daily routine. We forget who we are. We forget who you are. We forget what the church is supposed to be. So here we are standing before you today with our human foibles and our short attention spans, asking that you would make yourself known to us, that you would help us to recognize the presence of the Holy, that you would continue to challenge us, inspire us, and make us into the people you want us to be. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you. Let us share in signs of reconciliation and peace.
Good morning. Well, I'm glad this service will greet me this morning. I had to make them do it twice at the 8:45 service. Hello, friends. How are you today? I got an announcement to make before we begin. Can I have a second? Okay. So I just wanted, first, I was asked to remind everybody that the shoe drive is still going on. That I believe this is your last week to bring your shoes in, any unwanted shoes, any and all shoes, they can be repurposed. And I also wanted to remind everyone that the backpack drive is still going on, that we have lots of tags out there still left, and they're due back this coming Sunday, the 6th. We're going to do a blessing over the backpacks, we're going to do a blessing over the kids going back to school, and we're going to hear all about the mission trip that the youth just got back from. So it's going to be a really great Sunday next week, and I encourage you all to attend. With that being said, good morning, my lovelies. How are you? Good. So I want to talk to you this morning about the alphabet. Do you know the alphabet? You do. Could you sing it for me? It's okay. Well, they know the alphabet. Yeah, good job. So, did you guys learn the alphabet first, or did you learn how to read first? You learned how to read before you learned the alphabet? Are you sure? I don't know. What about you? Did you learn to read first, or did you learn the alphabet?
Alphabet.
You learned the alphabet. Well, okay. Well, that's the order you're supposed to learn it in. Do you know why? Because the letters make words. Thank you very much. And words make sentences. Very good. And sentences make paragraphs, and paragraphs make stories. It's one big circle. Oh, we're getting even more technical now. But the foundation, the very first thing that we are to learn is the alphabet, because we can't learn words until we learn what the letters are and what sounds they make, right? But as Christians, we have something that we have to learn first as Christians too. When the disciples and the teachers were talking to Jesus, they said, what's the most important out of all of the rules that they had? And Jesus said the most important thing was to love God and to love your neighbor. And that's kind of like the alphabet for Christians. These two little things, to love God and to love your neighbor, these are the things that the foundation of us as disciples are, because we can't do anything else until we learn to do those two things. It's how we become disciples. It's how we minister to people. It's how we talk to people. It's how we learn to pray for people, by learning first how to love God and how to love others. Okay? Well, if you would join with me in a prayer this morning before we leave, please bow your head. Dear God, thank you for giving us foundations. Help us to love who you are.
Help us to love who you are.
And help us to love one another.
Help us.
Thank you for your blessings.
Thank you for your blessings.
And thank you for your love.
Thank you for your
love. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
I received the prayer request and the joys, and the first one brings me a big smile. It's I don't want to think about them being that old, but Bill and Mary Lou Grove had a wedding anniversary and 72 years of being married, and they may be watching this today, so he was just a young whippersnapper when I got started, and And Bishop Wickey ordained me as pastor. Bishop Wickey was ordaining pastor for my dad sometime after World War II. So lots of good history there, but many joyful memories of Bill and Mary Lou. And so we pray God's blessing on them on their special anniversary. We're going to pray this day for the residents of Arthur B. Hodges at Edgewood Summit. I think there's about a half a dozen folks from this congregation who live there now. Bill and Harriet Deal. Remembering them. Lorella Bogus, Ginger Sargent and family, and I apologize if I don't pronounce these correctly. Chris Schneid, the family of Kenny Miller, the Hayes family, Ricky and Robert, Pat Eisner White, Dreamela and Roger Nichols, and Anna Marie, the Reinhardt family, HCKH, and for the people of Haiti, following some of that in the news of recently, and certainly would add people of Ukraine and other areas of the world where there is turmoil that needs our prayers especially.
Listen to your children pray.
What is it, O God, about us that when we are reminded that we are your children, that we find in that incredible comfort, and that we want to be the little ones sitting at the feet of Jesus, and we want to be the ones who get to sing and wave the palm branches, and we want to be the ones that are out in the field, and we want to bring out our basket and share our fish and bread with the masses and stir them to do the same. Thanks for music that takes us back to where we need to be. That reminds us that we are children of God and that what we are to be has not yet been revealed, but it's filled with promises and hope and possibilities and lots of joy and a kingdom of heaven that is at hand. And how we rejoice in that, and how we are blessed by that possibility, that excitement, what's on the horizon, not knowing and yet knowing, anxious but yet confident, blessed upon blessing on this journey of life. Thanks for our Bishop Bill and for Mary Lou, who we celebrate this day in their marriage. Thanks for our friends and neighbors who have found new homes here in the Charleston area but are still a part of our congregation and part of our church family. Thanks for those far and near who this day gather in your name to worship with children of God around the world, for your word that gets proclaimed, for good news and great joy for all people, for love that knows no bounds, for grace that is still, even to this day, amazing. In this day, O God, we will remember those places in conflict and in struggle, places in war, whether it be nations or even within families and neighborhoods, communities. We pray for the peace that passes understanding. We pray for that spirit to descend once more to remind us that we are beloved children of the Heavenly Father. We pray, O God, for our congregation and those around this community and the work they've been called to do, to bring a light to this community, to join one another in harmony and in this journey together, to be witnesses of the kingdom. We pray for others whom we have named this day and who those that we keep in our own hearts. And we pray, O God, for ourselves, needing your forgiveness, standing in the need of prayer, knowing, O God, that your spirit still guides us, your love will rescue us, your grace abounds, and your truths will set us free. So bless us in our own journey, in all that we are about, that in all that we do, and all that we are, we will be witnesses of the one who is our life now and forevermore, even Jesus Christ, who taught us to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Psalter today is from Psalm 1. It can be found on page 738 of your hymnal. Will you please sing the responses and read along with me? Blessed are those who do not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of scoffers, but their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on God's law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water that yield their fruit in season, and their leaves do not wither. In all that they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish.
I'll say more about the Scout event later on. I want to share some things about that. Just know that there were people from all over the world there, which was pretty amazing. On a Friday morning, a group came through from Israel, and adults and youth, and I told some of the adult leaders that on a Friday morning before the Sabbath, I had walked up Masada near the Dead Sea. Masada would have been that place, that fort, that town where the Jews would fend off the Romans for the very last time before they were defeated by the Romans in about 70 AD. It's a sacred place. It's a place where soldiers still join the army officially. It's a place where many people come to remember those sorrowful times, but rejoice in where they are now and to prepare for the what's next in terms of how they would live as a nation. So it's a very sacred atmosphere. In that place, there was an area that had been excavated, and it was the synagogue. And this was a group of people from Elizabeth Memorial were with me, and one of them says, "Preach." And so I stood there and I shared the Shema, which is the Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, your Lord is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and strength. And so I told these men from the scouts there who were from Israel that I had worshiped in the ancient synagogue on Masada. And they said, so you were Masada. I said, yes, 5 a.m. before it topped 100 degrees, we were on top of that mountain. And it was an amazing thing about that sacred place, it was hard to leave because it was there was something about that. And all those who had taken their pilgrimage there for some 2,000 years to remember. And this connects into what we're hearing today, by the way. One of the scribes came near and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that he answered them well, he asked him, which commandment is the first of all? Jesus answered, the first is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Then the scribe said to him, you are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and beside him there is no other. And to love him with all your heart, with all the understanding, with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself, this is much more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. When Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. And after this, no one dared to ask him any more questions. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. We had been to the Grand Tetons to do some hiking and really enjoyed it. It was beautiful out through there. A little scared of a large bear I saw in the woods, but he went on up the mountain, so all was well. And we kept away from each other. We got ready to leave. We went to Idaho Falls Airport to get on the plane. And I got on the plane. I passed about the third row down on the left was a man sitting there. And I looked at him and I said, good morning. And he said, good morning. And I felt the need, I'm a kind of a touchy guy, and so I felt the need to tap him on the shoulder and say to him, I appreciate you. And he looked at me and he said, thank you. And he looked very humble and very welcoming of that. So I went back and I sat down next to my wife and told her that I had greeted this gentleman. And she said, did you tell him why you appreciated him? And I said, well, there were a bunch of people behind me with their stuff. And I felt the need to move on, and I didn't want to feel like a groupie as well. So I went on to my seat and sat down. But then I sat down, and I thought to myself, I should have told him. I should have told him why I appreciated him. I should have told him about a village called Bykova in Russia. I should have told him about a woman named Anna, kind of a chubby woman, real short, and kind of walked like this, but she could outwalk me like nobody's business, even with my long legs. I should have told her about Anna's eyeglasses, which were glass and had a crack down the side. She didn't care. She could still see just fine. I should have told her that one time I said to her, you don't make much money. She says, I don't have children except for all these, and we're all taken care of. I should have told her that Anna was the principal of an orphanage of about 100 children. I should have told him that Anna took us to the camp where all the children were, and we played football, we played soccer. I should have told her all the stories about, should have told him all the stories about that soccer game. How Anna took a soup ladle that they'd brought for dinner that night, to serve dinner, but she used it as a weapon to keep us from scoring. So anytime I got near to score a goal, she would have whacked me with a soup ladle. And we'd all laugh. I should have told her about the coach for our team who had been an orphan, who grew up in that orphanage and was loved and beloved so much that he became their coach and their teacher in physical education and brought them incredible joy. I should have told them about that. I should have told them about a young man named Seth. Seth, who came from Fairmont, West Virginia, who was part of our group, who brought us such joy. Seth, who told me one night that he felt a call to ministry. And Seth, who had said that someday he wanted to be a pastor and fill that church in Fairmont. And I should have told him the sad thing was it that Seth passed away that fall when he was in a car wreck. But he filled that church, and people sang songs of praise, and they rejoiced in his life. But I should have told them that Seth made everybody so happy, and those kids couldn't get their fill of him. They just loved on him, and he loved on them as well. I should have told them about Seth. I should have told them that our team was called Banan Republica, because it translated really well into Russian from Banana Republic. So that was simple enough to do that. I should have told him on that plane that when the kids scored, they would go, hey, because they had seen transliterated on the TV in Russian, the TV show Happy Days. I should have told Henry Winkler that day all of that and more, because he would have never have known that half a world away, reruns of Happy Days made Happy Days for these children and connected us with kids halfway around the world forever. I should have told him that, because he never would have known. I tried to get in his fan club and write him a letter, and I couldn't figure out how to do that, so someday, maybe I'll see him on another plane, and I can tell him. These Kingdom of Heaven moments where you see somebody and it takes you back to another place. The team that went over there was a volunteers and mission team through United Methodist Church. Back then, it was Tom Clark that organized that. There were a bunch of us. Built a playground, huge playground, reinforced everything to make it strong enough to last for years, and just had a delight with his wonderful staff who were of a profound faith and who welcomed us. And I think and pray about those children and hope they're well in the midst of all this conflict with Russia and Ukraine that we're all somehow tied into, praying, of course, for God's peace, that they're okay. But I should have told him those things. There was the gospel story is this wonderful story of a man who comes near to hear this conversation taking place between Jesus and the legal community, the religious and legal community, debating back and forth. And there was nothing wrong with that. It was healthy stuff. And he's intrigued by it. He's drawn to it. And he decides he's going to ask a question. Sometimes I can almost think about maybe the first time in class you ever held your hand up, you know. He just asked the question. He came close and he asked the question, which is the greatest commandment? And Jesus says what everybody else would have said, the Shema. He said, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, your Lord is the one. You love the Lord your God with all your heart and your mind and your soul and your strength. And then he said, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. And there's this incredible part because this man gives Jesus a compliment. You're right. You're right. And just a genuine connection between he and Jesus. For you're right. You're right. And he repeats the same thing Jesus had just said, repeats it back to the teacher. And then Jesus says this incredible thing. He says, you are not far from the kingdom of heaven. Listen, love that. Did you ever have it as a student, you know, and your teacher, you know, and you're teaching, and all of a sudden the kids are just that close. Oh, you just about have it. You just about have it. I never got tired of that. I went to school for 19 straight years. And I never got tired of a teacher saying to me, you're not far. You about have this figured out. Because it's that teaser that's out there of promise, of possibility. You're not far from the kingdom of heaven. And the guy must have been thinking, oh, I'm on track. I'm on track. I've got it. I'm going in the right direction. A kingdom of heaven moment. I had a friend that years ago, we were out visiting someplace, doing some things, and he sees something. He says, kingdom of heaven. And it became contagious. It became contagious because all of a sudden he was claiming, what do we call it? That whole blessed assurance, you know, a foretaste of glory divine, you know, the old hymn, that little sense that something here is a taste of heaven. And he'd point something out and say, kingdom of heaven. And I don't care. And I do this and I love it because sometimes I'll do it and embarrass our grandchildren. Even in a public place, if I'm in Kroger and somebody's reaching down a box of Cheerios to somebody in a wheelchair, I'll say, kingdom of heaven, kingdom of heaven. If I see a parent giving love to their child and being patient with them, doing it the right way, kingdom of heaven. Kingdom. Every now and then, you even get an amen out of people, you know. Amen. But there's this rejoicing that people are aching for, to be that close and to be recognized and reminded that they're that close to the kingdom of heaven. You're just that close. That's what it's going to be like. This is a hint of that. I picked up a group of people at the Dulles Airport in D.C. And while I was waiting, there's this long hallway where you've come through customs, and maybe you've done this. You come through customs, you come down this long hallway. It feels like you're out there by yourself. But in that hallway, there's a place of permission giving where the loved ones can come out to greet them. And so you'd have the executives come by, and then their friends would say, well, welcome back. I hope you had a good meeting. Those kind of things. But then you had people who hadn't seen each other for a generation. And you got somebody, they're coming from the African continent or Europe or Asia, South America, and they're getting off that plane, and they're coming across there, and here comes somebody running like a scene from a movie. And they're embracing each other and wailing with tears. And I'm sitting there going, oh my gosh. You know, I ain't too proud to cry, you know. But it's like kingdom of heaven. This is what it's going to be like. This is the kingdom of heaven. This is where we all come together in the kingdom. Right here. It's being rehearsed right here on earth. That's what it looks like. That's what it tastes like. That's what it feels like. You know, you sit there and you're just kind of honored to be there, you know, like a guest of honor, you know, just happy to be at the banquet where all this stuff takes place. These wonderful acts of loving kindness that take place, and over again, you begin to say, oh, a kingdom of heaven moment that we get a chance to affirm and join that man from so long ago who said those very things. We went, when we were in Israel a few years ago, like I said, the group from Elizabeth Memorial, we did this on our own, and we decided that 1 week we walked 49 miles because we wanted to see it on the ground. That's the way volunteers and missions is. You get a chance to see way beyond what tourists would ever see because you get to meet the real people and hang out and find out how genuinely similar they are to us. And we were on the Palestinian bus going to Bethlehem. And I watched as an elderly woman gets up out of her chair. It's hot. She walks off this bus, starts to go down, turns and calls out to somebody in Arabic who hands her her water bottle. She takes a drink of the water, hands it back to her, and gets ready to leave. And just then, the bus driver says, stop, tells her to stop in Arabic. I translated that one. It was pretty easy. And she stopped. And he opened up his glove compartment of the bus, pulled out his lunch pail, pulled out his bottle of water, and handed it to her. And she does this, and off it goes. So I'm on my way out, and I can't leave well enough alone. So I'm leaving the bus later on. I reached up, and I touched him on the shoulder. And I said to him, I saw what you did. And I went like this. And he went like this. And we shook hands. And he about broke my hands. Because suddenly we're brothers with a vision of the kingdom of heaven. Right there in that moment. If you give even a drink of water in my name, you will not lose your reward. Remember that one? Simple stuff. Foretaste of glory divine, hints of the kingdom of heaven. We were taking a group. I was chaplain at Marshall for 14 years, Habitat for Humanity. We're heading to Homestead, Florida to build some houses. And we stopped at Jacksonville. We stopped at a Wendy's. And we're getting ready to leave. We have a rental van, no emblems on it or anything, just us getting in the van. And a man comes up to me with a bottle of liquor in his hand and says to me, you need to help me. And I said, I'm not from around here. I don't know how to help you. I don't know what to do. He says, no, but it's your job. I'm like, ah. Isn't that nice? Isn't that Christian? Isn't that humbling? And I said, okay, come with me. I walked him back inside to the manager, and I said, this man needs help. And the manager looked at me with incredible compassion and says to me, I'll take care of it. And my sense was, this manager has been on that journey. He knew exactly who to call. He knew exactly what to do. He wasn't intimidated at all. He made no excuses like I did. And I left that man with him, and I was confident that it was going to be just fine. Kingdom of Heaven moment with a perfect stranger. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Drinks of water, strangers, just incredible opportunities. During COVID, we worked at the community cupboard in Hurricane. A man comes in a pickup truck that I could never afford. It was nice. I mean, it was a nice truck. He was paycheck to paycheck. Average car payment's about, what, $700 a month, and his was probably $1,200 for that truck. Paycheck to paycheck, COVID hits, he loses his job. He's humiliated. He comes in and says to me, I am so ashamed to be here. I've never been to one of these places in my life. And I looked at him, I said, Jesus feeds everybody. And he says, I guess that's right. So get fed, and when you're back to work, pay it forward. Okay, it's all right. Kingdom of Heaven moment. Very humbling, teachable moment about life. That everybody, so many people in America and around the world, they're just one paycheck away from being destitute, coming for help. Never dreamed he'd be there. But there he was. But grace abounds, does it not? Does it not? Kingdom of Heaven moments. We were on our way to Tennessee with some folks from the church here and others with a volunteer mission team after they'd had a flood in a place called Waverly. We stopped in Kentucky to get gas, and I'm going to prepay, and my buddy hollers, Jim, don't pay. I said, what do you mean? And I looked, and there was a man in another pickup truck reaching around the bend, puts his credit card into the machine, gets back in his truck, drives off and waves and says, God bless y'all. And he had told my friend David Stilgenbauer, I know what you do, because he saw the name on the truck. I know what you do. It's like, man, one more along the way. One more Kingdom of Heaven moment. John Lennon wrote this wonderful lullaby to his son. And it said, life is what happens when you're busy making, in other words, other plans. Other plans. He didn't know he was writing to him, did he? That's life. Kingdom of Heaven moments when you're busy making other plans, one after another. I wrote to Bishop Ives and said to him, I'm finally taking this bicycle ride from Cincinnati to Cleveland. Because when my brother passed away and his brother passed away, we talked about things we ought to be just doing right now. And 20 years ago, he said to me, you should take your bicycle trip now and get away. Ride across Ohio. And I finally did it. So I wrote him a note. It was nice. I put on Facebook a picture of me crossing an old bridge in my hometown of St. Mary's and said, I'm getting ready to ride my bicycle across Ohio. And somebody wrote back and said, I hope you are armed. I hope that you are armed. And this person who wrote back, I helped raise her, so she knew better. She knew better. But boy, we do that in America, don't we? You know, we're always ready to be on the defensive, always ready to think the worst, always ready to worry about something, always ready to have a knee-jerk reaction. But yet I wanted to get on Facebook and say, live by the sword and die by the sword. All that kind of thing. Or to say, Paul said, live at peace with one another as much as it's possible. Right? Or the psalmist who said, how good it is when brothers and sisters live together in harmony. I wanted to preach on Facebook. But instead I wrote back and I said, we're going to be armed with goodwill. We're going to be armed with goodwill. All the way up through there, my buddy, who I never told him this story, my buddy kept saying, boy, there's a lot of goodwill around here. Everybody's so nice and kind and encouraging. And we kept looking for that, and we didn't have to look far. It was right there, one after another of Kingdom of Heaven moments. Inspiring. We were going through Amish country, and I rang my little bell on my bicycle that my grandson makes fun of. And these Amish people put their tools down, turned, and began to wave. We were going through the project side of Cleveland. An old black man sitting in his front yard on the lawn chair, and he yells, "You're almost there. You're almost there. Keep it going, man. Keep it going." It was incredible. The goodwill after goodwill after goodwill. Kingdom of Heaven moments. People rehearsing for what life ought to be and will be in the life that is to come. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in, yeah, that place, that opportunity, that possibility, Kingdom of Heaven. It's amazing in the scriptures, the angels say, good news and great joy for all people. John the Baptist proclaims, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and then they locked him up. Jesus starts proclaiming, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. John sends a note saying, are you the one or is something wrong? And Jesus said to John, tell John this. Tell him the dead are being raised. Tell him that those that are broken are being made well. Tell them the peace is being proclaimed. Tell them all these things that are happening. And don't be ashamed of it. Don't be ashamed of it. And then they began to celebrate John. It was this great moment because John lost heart, and Jesus restored that for him and for his disciples and for all of us when we lose heart, to once again open your eyes and see the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Kingdom of heaven moments constantly are at hand. So let me tell you about the scouts for a minute. There was only 15,000 there. Scouts and leaders. And when they said to us, we're going to make 5,000 buckets, we had no clue how to time that. But each 2 hours, 400 young people would make 200 buckets every 2 hours. Well, they didn't need that. Within 45 minutes to an hour, 200 buckets were done, stacked, and wrapped, and ready to go. Ready to be picked up this Tuesday and Wednesday by the National Guard and taken to our warehouses. Just that quickly. One after another, Saudi Arabia, Israel, Mexico, England, all over the United States, great kids. The Manhattan kids would come up and shake hands with you like it was a business deal. It was so funny. The country kids would give you the high five. It was just culturally and multiculturally, it was awesome. 40% female. 40% female, inclusive, diverse, kingdom of heaven. And I'm sitting there going, and nobody who volunteered to go with us, period, in that 100-degree heat, one time complained. They were like, this is really good. I wish I could have done this more, because they knew this worked. I got these kids together. I sat down, and I talked to leadership, and they let me lead them in country roads, just a chorus. And you'd be amazed the number of people who just got teared up about that. We sang the chorus twice. And there was something about those lyrics to the place I belong. I belong. And they all wanted to tell me stories. So we're having these quick stories taking place of where I'm from. And yeah, we have mudslides in California. Yeah, New Mexico, we have brush fires. Ohio, yeah, we had that train wreck. And there's chemicals. And my West Virginia kids who made me proud just to see them, all their Mountaineer and Marshall stuff on, you know. It was like everybody spoke the same language. It was this Pentecostal moment of everybody understanding about human suffering, what it means to be coming home, what it means to belong, and what it means to do something. And so I had them repeat, hope, hope, hope. And I said, you're building a bucket of hope. And I said, when you get your note done as to who you are and where you're from and you're put it on top of that bucket, the next person that sees that is going to be in a crisis and have a disaster going on. But they're going to have hope because that bucket's going to open up and all of a sudden it may only be one little portion of their house is going to get cleaned up. And the rest of the house, it ain't ready yet, but that doesn't matter because they're going to be living over here in sanitary conditions until the rest of it gets done by other groups of people. And I looked at these kids, and it might be you, and it might be you, and it might be you. Ain't that great? And they would come up and they'd say, how do we get bill buckets back home? How do we do this back home? People came from Puerto Rico. They were like, who do we get in touch with in Puerto Rico? So quickly, you Google it, of course. And there we are looking up how to find help in Puerto Rico, where to give them buckets. What do I do now? What must I do? Just like it's right out of the Gospels. What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? I want this. You can taste it. Kingdom of heaven moments. The man was told by Jesus, you're not far from the kingdom. And the guy was like, oh man, he's walking tall. He's walking tall because he knows he's on the right track. We're called to be on the right track, aren't we? We're called to follow the one who is our life forevermore, to be witnesses of the good news and great joy, and call it when you see it. Because enough other people complain about everything going on in the world. We don't need that. People don't need bad news. They need good news, great joy, all people. Amen. I invite you, if you would, as you were able to stand, for the affirmation litany. God, today we believe that you dwell in all who confess Jesus as the Son of God.
God, today we will open our ears to hear each one who confesses Jesus as the Son of God.
God, we believe you invite us to accept each other as sisters and brothers.
God, today we accept and embrace all who call themselves by your name.
God, we believe you call us to love each other as we do ourselves.
God, we all are ours. We will strive to love our brothers and sisters from every denomination.
God, we believe you ask us to use our gifts to serve each other in unity and understanding.
God,
God, we believe that in unity together, we will come to a full knowledge of Christ.
God, may we grow together in the knowledge of the one in whom all things fit together. Amen. You may be seated. Just a couple of quick announcements before our offering. If you look through everything that you received in your bulletin today, most of these are opportunities for you to create kingdom of heaven moments in someone's life. You have an opportunity to volunteer for Faith in Action. Ashley already reminded us of the backpack drive. There are plenty of other things in the trifold that all point to the ability to make kingdom of God moments for our brothers and sisters outside the walls of this church. Also want to remind you to fill out the connection card and share any information as we now prepare for our tithes and God's offerings.
I mentioned this morning that the early service, the first time I ever heard this hymn, it was in Spanish, which was the original language. You can see it's a little somewhat choppy by how it's translated, but it's the best they could do. But it was beautiful to sit there, and then the second time around, they sang it in English, so I had the opportunity to embrace what, to me, became one of my favorite hymns. Yes, believe it or not, I've written scriptures in that hymn that I want in my funeral someday. So if you're around, come sing me home, would you? I'd appreciate that. But I love it. I asked the young people if they'd been swimming this summer, and they had, and I never saw water I didn't love to jump into or take a boat and hop in with my boat and sometimes my fishing pole, and what that means to go to get in the water and just go wherever it takes you, and what adventures lie ahead in those oceans and rivers and creeks and all those wonderful places where the Lord is with us in those places, where there's no need for gold or weapons, just knowing that God's spirit wind, the spirit wind, will guide us where we need to go. Kingdom of Heaven moments. They're waiting for all of us. So go forth in faith, knowing that God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit are with us now and forevermore. We all say, amen. Amen.